Good evening, folks. Welcome to the April meeting of the New York Arts Chapter. And this evening we have a quite wonderful program, if I have to say so myself, since I helped put it together, with no small help from Dennis, who is actually the creator of it. Oh, that's much better. Just want to let you know, the usual, it's the Sonic Arts Center at CCNY, which gives us this room every month, offers a four-year Bachelor of Fine Arts degrees in music with a concentration in music and audio technology. Their program provides an in-depth curriculum emphasizing real-world skills with project-based approach. Students enjoy a well-rounded program with emphasis on audio technology, music theory, orchestration, and history to help them compete in a field that today demands an ever-growing and highly diverse skill set. All Arts New York Chapter meetings are free and open to the public. Voluntary contributions to help defray our expenses are welcome. In fact, due to contributions that have been coming in, we just bought a mixing board, which we're now going to be using for every program to get the level right, as well as some equalization to kind of sweeten up the sound coming into this room. Dennis is going to present a program, as you can see, on FRITZ REINER, the Columbia recordings of FR and the PSO, Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra, which were done between the years 1940 and 47. From January 40 to November of 47, Columbia recorded the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra. The sessions in Pittsburgh, first in Carnegie Concert Hall, then in Syria Mosque, were interrupted for nearly 3 years by the famous Petrillo Ban, the first of them, 1942 to 44, which coincided with an orchestra shorn of some of its best players due to wartime military service. Recordings resumed in early 1945 and continued at regular intervals each season thereafter. The final Reiner PSO recording of Strauss's Ein Heldenleben, like all its predecessors, was mastered on 16.5-inch lacquer discs rotating at 33 1/3 RPM, the same speed as the Columbia LP, which was launched only a few months later. By that time, Reiner had departed Pittsburgh for the Metropolitan Opera in New York. These recordings were the first made under its own name by Reiner, who rebuilt the Pittsburgh Symphony after his arrival in 1938 from the Curtis Institute in Philadelphia. Building on the reorganization of his predecessor, Otto Klemperer, Reiner profited from the availability of many emigre players fleeing war and fascism, enabling him to quickly improve the orchestra's personnel. This program will be part of a survey of all the Pittsburgh Symphony recordings to be presented at Ars National Conference in Pittsburgh in late May. This evening's program will offer an expanded sampling of the PSO Columbia recordings in its best-sounding available sources, original 78 RPM shellac, LP reissues, and Masterworks Heritage CD reissues, the latter produced directly from the original lacquer masters. Dennis Rooney's collecting career began when Harry Truman was in the White House. His interest in recordings followed him through subsequent careers in broadcasting, writing, and audio production. He produced many reissues for Sony Classical, the most significant of which was the award-winning Masterworks Heritage line. As a producer and consultant to the record industry, he has contributed to many important CD reissues of historic recordings. As a member of ARSC, he has been a frequent presenter at conferences and workshops, is classical music judge of the Book Awards panel, a member of the technical committee since 1996, the steering committee of ARSC New York Chapter since 2008, and reviews books and recordings for the ARSC Journal. He regularly contributes features and reviews to the Strad, and is an occasional contributor to BBC Music Magazine, Classic Record Collector, American Record Guide, and MusicalAmerica.com. Ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce Mr. Rooney, who I can't figure out if you're going to have any time to sleep after doing all that. But you don't sleep. That's it. But anyway, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Rooney, I think you're going to be in for quite a treat this evening.
Thank you for that generous introduction, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I see a finger held up asking a question.
Was it 40 or 41 that they started?
They started recording in 40. However, the 1940 sessions, with one exception, were aborted due to what the British would call mains frequency problems in Carnegie Music Hall. And it gives me great pleasure to pronounce Andrew Carnegie's surname correctly. since the opposite seems to be honored all too often. Anyway, we're going to Pittsburgh, and that's a Carnegie place where they say Carnegie. So get ready. The placard basically gives you the gist of what I'm about to do. In Pittsburgh, I'm going to have 20 minutes, just like my colleagues, who will be involved in a presentation devoted to the Pittsburgh Symphony recordings from Reiner to the present day. We used the greater time available to us here to prepare a program with more extensive excerpts and a little more variety. So you're getting something that they won't get up in Pittsburgh, where they have to spend a hefty registration and hostelry fee. You get it for just having to get yourselves up to this wonderful auditorium. So anyway, I'm happy to have as many of you as have come out tonight to present this program. There are two biographies of Fritz Reiner, one by Philip Hart and the other by Kenneth Morgan. They remain the most useful sources of information on the career and personality of a man described by one of them as a maestro and martinet. Reiner was an intensely private person with no interest in skill, in being personable. Artistically, his standards brooked no compromise, and he was relentless in the pursuit of them. He was not one to rage a la Toscanini or stamp his feet. His displeasure was quieter and more relentless. He was born Reiner Friedrich on the, that's the Hungarian style, otherwise it's Friedrich or Frederick Reiner, in 1888 into a prosperous Jewish family in Budapest. Here is, let me see if I can find it. First we're going to show you the standard portrait, which shows Reiner, who was only 5'5", in a classic pose. Here he is at 4. Look at that wary gaze into the camera. That wariness continued throughout his life, defined him in many, many ways. His family supported his exceptional musical talents, although his father wanted him to study law as a backup. But when his father died, so did Reiner's legal studies, and he devoted himself to studying at the Franz Liszt Conservatory in Budapest, where his teachers included Zoltán Kodály for composition and Béla Bartók for piano. In 1914, he took a post in Dresden, where he conducted throughout World War I, and during his stay there, was befriended by Richard Strauss, and that composer's works figured largely in Reiner's repertoire throughout his career. He received a lifetime appointment in Dresden. But in 1921, he came to the United States to be conductor of the Cincinnati Symphony Orchestra. Perhaps post-war devastation and the allure of American fees in gold dollars influenced his decision to emigrate. He spent most of the next decade in Cincinnati, where he learned to grow roses, and he also became an accomplished photographer. But his love life got him into trouble in Cincinnati with the ladies who ran the orchestra in those days, when his affair with actress Carlotta Irwin became too scandalous to ignore, at least in Cincinnati. His resignation was followed in 1931 by the announcement that he would take up residence in Philadelphia. There he is in Cincinnati, again looking warily at the camera. And here he is with Mary Curtis Bach, the patroness and founder of the Curtis Institute of Music. She appointed Reiner to head the orchestra and opera programs, and he conducted the student orchestra, training many conductors along the way, the most famous of which was Leonard Bernstein. But Samuel Barber, seen here in a shipboard photo, was also a pupil. When Reiner was chosen conductor in Pittsburgh in 1938, the orchestra had reorganized after a difficult period in its history in which its very survival was highly uncertain. His inaugural concert in 1938 featured a program of works by J.S. Bach, Richard Strauss, Mozart, the Eine kleine Nachtmusik, and the Brahms First Symphony. In 1939, Reiner had made his first commercial recordings with the New York Philharmonic, but they had been released anonymously on the world's greatest music label, produced and manufactured by RCA Victor and marketed by the New York Post as a subscription builder. At the same time, Columbia Records, which had been acquired in 1938 by the Columbia Broadcasting System, began to make a determined effort to compete with RCA Victor. In 1940, they announced that the price of a 12-inch classical 78 RPM disc would be cut half, from $2 to $1. At the same time, they were continuing to sign up American orchestras to expand their catalog. After Cleveland, Minneapolis, and the New York Philharmonic were added to their roster, Pittsburgh joined the ranks, with a contract commencing in 1940. The Columbia remote engineering team set up in Carnegie Music Hall in March of that year and recorded 14 sides of Wagner. They encountered significant difficulties with fluctuating electric service, which spoiled all but one of the sides. They did not return until the following year, and then setting up in Syria Mosque, where the orchestra's concerts took place. This building is just a memory now to people who were inside it during Reiner's concerts. You will notice on the release sheet, there's only one item at the very top of the March 14th, 1940 list that has a line drawn through it. That line indicates that it was approved. Now, there's a certain amount of ambiguity about that, but in any event, I don't have one to play. We will just tell you what happened, because the Syria Mosque session was actually the first real session, and that was early in 1941. And this time it was Richard Strauss which began the session. So here is a somewhat kludged abridgment of Don Juan. The violin solo is by Hugo Kauberg, who was in his final season as Pittsburgh's concertmaster. Thank you. That particular recording was derived from a mid-1950s LP transfer, which presumably used the original lacquers as their source. That was the usual way in handling this material. As you can hear, there's some slight speed instability, which was also a characteristic of Columbia's playback of those lacquers. But the vitality of this performance, it just swept all before it. He had had to compete in the catalog with a rather schwach Bruno Walter version, and one that was good but not very exciting with Fritz Busch and the BBC Symphony. So when this hit the market, it really brought the Pittsburgh Symphony and Reiner to the forefront of what was exciting about having this collaboration. The problem is, when Reiner heard the playbacks of the 78 RPM commercial discs that were derived from the lacquers, he was always appalled by the gulf between the quality of what he had heard in the test pressings made from the original playbacks and what finally got through to the product made for sale. And what we're going to do is demonstrate just exactly what that gulf could be. Excuse me, please. Later, the music of another Strauss was recorded, and this is going to be another one of my wonderful truncations, this time of Wiener Blut, which documents Reiner's skill in obtaining the authentic Viennese flavor. The Strauss and the next item, one of the Wagner works re-recorded at the same session, comes from 78 RPM shellac discs and of rather poor quality transfers from the French label Lys. We've done our best to improve the listenability of the originals, and here is the prelude to Act 3 of Wagner's Lohengrin. Of excerpts come from the original 16-inch lacquer master discs. Seth and I transferred a large number of them when planning for the series that originally appeared in 1996 as Masterworks Heritage. But not all were eventually used, so in some cases what you will hear this evening has not been heard before outside of Columbia Studios. When recording resumed, in November of 1941, Reiner conducted Debussy's Iberia and another Strauss tone poem, Don Quixote, which featured Gregor Piatigorsky in the title role, as it were. Piatigorsky was a Columbia artist and thus available. It was frustrating to Reiner that despite the appearance of world-famous artists in Pittsburgh, conflicting contracts made most of them unavailable for recording. In supporting roles in Don Quixote were Reiner's new concertmaster, Henri Temianka, and violist Vladimir Bakalynikov, whose impersonation, musically, of Sancho Panza may be the greatest ever done. We're going to listen to the end of the score.
Thank you.
It's when you hear something that quiet that you realize how much ambient noise is in this room. That's the great advantage to having master lacquer material of that quality at one's disposal and attempting to bring it to reissue. Now that is a standard, what they call a lab sheet for Columbia recording jobs from this period. You see the date, the job number, the name of the ensemble, of course, and then you will see, if I can read this, yes. This page starts with disc number 8 and continues through disc number 12. And they mark the item recorded, whether it was approved or disapproved. And for instance, the first cut was not approved because it was found to be too long at 4 minutes 50 seconds, when the average length of a 12-inch 78 RPM side was about 4:25. But as you can see, they were quite productive by and large, because everything else seems to have been approved. However, notice the last two items on this sheet. When we worked on these lacquers, we concentrated on Don Quixote. We didn't work on the other items that are shown here. But we noticed two sides of Mussorgsky's Night on Bald Mountain, and they are the last two recordings made at the session. In the right-hand margin, hard to see, it says 9 minutes left when they began it. So they went right through. The first side had an oboe mistake in it. Reiner did not okay it. But if you look in the okay column on the left, the third one in, it is marked okay. Now, it's too bad about the oboe mistake, but this performance is tremendously exciting and better recorded than the later version recorded in 1945. It's so interesting that it only shows up on this document. The other matrix cards for the Columbia 78s from this period do not show it. So it's too much fun not to play it, and we propose to do so right now. Thank you. The solo flute, by the way, was a young Julius Baker. There were a lot of people who joined the Pittsburgh Symphony because they felt if they could last a couple of years under Reiner, they could go to any job in the rest of the world, in the orchestra world, that is. Reiner was a demanding man almost beyond belief, but he really hated weak players, and he was relentless in his going after them. He wouldn't stop. During the war, a lot of the members of the orchestra were drafted, because the war, of course, came only less than a month after that session ended, same time as I was a strapping five-week-old. And in any event, the personnel of the orchestra changed oftentimes as much as 25% to 30% each season. And during the war years, it was hard to get people to fill the ranks where military service had eaten most of them up. So lots of people came in and went. And there's a story told in the legends of the Pittsburgh Symphony about a young cellist who sat right in front of Reiner. He kept making mistakes. Reiner just kept looking at him because that was a favorite technique of his. He just kept staring at them until they became completely unnerved. Well, this poor kid finally got up, took his cello, ran off stage, and was never seen again. And I didn't make that up. There's another wonderful story because Reiner was a taskmaster in rehearsal. If he wasn't getting the results he wanted, he didn't have any constraints to make things happen stand by stand or section by section. So in the performance of the Tannhäuser Overture, or rehearsal I should say, where the violin figurations that come against the Pilgrim's Chorus are a trial to many violinists, and particularly ones who aren't shall we say, at the top of their game, everybody was plotting on this phrase. And so Reiner just said, stand by stand. He started with the concertmaster. He made a mistake. Then the assistant concertmaster. And all the way down to the end of the section, to a man named Stuart Discount, who had joined the orchestra in 1946. Stuart played the passage perfectly with a handkerchief over his left hand. Reiner peered at him and he said, very good, Mr. Discount. Perhaps you would like to share your fingering with your colleagues. Discount looked at him and said, they can pay me to find out. So, when recording resumed in November of 1941, Reiner conducted Debussy's Iberia. I'm sorry, I'm reading the wrong section. My apologies. We're going to take two. By March of 1945, when the Columbia crew returned to Syria Mosque, the end of World War II was in sight. Japan had begun full retreat, and supplies of shellac were becoming available once again. Determined to make up for lost time, Columbia recorded a full schedule of repertoire, including some significant Reiner versions of works to which he did not return. One is this little Tchaikovsky confection, which is played out of order because, again, it was the last music recorded at the end of that session. Thank you. Shostakovich's Sixth Symphony was one of the works Reiner recorded in these sessions, and it proved a delightful discovery when I worked on it for the Masterworks Heritage reissue, especially as the previous 78 and LP issues sounded so ugly. But faced with the master lacquers, all those layers of bad equalization and distortion were nowhere to be found.
Thank you.
when you're lucky enough to be able to listen to these lacquers and hear the quality that's in them, the detail, the incredible detail, and the dynamic range, there's a sense of the past falling away. Unless, of course, you can't stand mono, in which case you're out of luck. Because
the timbre is very clear in these two.
Right, because there's no post-equalization in any of them. They are, as they came off the lacquers, at the sessions. The idea was not to preserve in some kind of a puristic fashion the sound of these. There was the expectation that they would be subject to further post-production, and that would involve gain writing and equalization to produce a saleable 78 RPM shellac product. But we just are very fortunate that we don't have to rely on that as our understanding of how Fritz Reiner conducted that Shostakovich movement. Leo Weiner was a close friend of Fritz Reiner, and he came frequently to Pittsburgh, as did Zoltan Kodály. We're going to hear some of their music in just a minute. But first, we're going to explore an interesting situation. When Reiner was chosen conductor in Pittsburgh in 1938, one of the things he set out to do was to perform all the Beethoven symphonies. And yet, all that Columbia would ever let him record was the second. It's a wonderful recording, but seems sad that we don't get a fourth or a seventh or a sixth. In any event, we have no right to complain, I guess. At least we have this one, which is wonderfully vivid and beautifully recorded.
Thank you.
two other items that we'll hear now were recorded at the same March 1945 sessions. Here's an excerpt from Leo Viner's Divertimento. As I mentioned earlier, Reiner and Viner were boyhood friends and remained friends throughout their lives. And the delicacy here is really lovely to hear. That recording wasn't released, and I think I know why. The delicacy and the lightness of tone could never have survived the roar of a 78 RPM Columbia shellac disc. Even an LP would have blanketed that kind of playing. Of course, the only option was to jack it up, but that would have coarsened the whole thing. So anyway, we can enjoy it, and the same fate befell Kodály's Dances of Galanta, which Reiner specifically disapproved in a letter to Gotthard Lieberson because he didn't like the clarinet play. Well, fortunately, the clarinetist at the time, Sigurd Bachmann, was living in New York. He had dated my mother and my sister and my Aunt Mary in the 30s when he and a guy named Fred Fox both played in the Minneapolis Symphony. He, of course, didn't remember anything about that, but that was okay. He was able to help us in choosing the takes that we had available. One of the great benefits of having these lacquer discs available is that they have unissued takes. Yes, the reason that they're unissued or unapproved are very obvious, but sometimes they contain perfectly played passages that help you out in the published take where there's something that's gone wrong. Anyway, I feel absolutely no reluctance to do that, since that's what often saves the recording, and the artist certainly would have preferred that. Today's editing makes these kinds of things routinely possible, which would have been simply unimaginable 70 years ago. Anyway, this is the finale of the Galanta Dances, and in one review of the Masterworks Heritage issue of this, somebody said Reiner seemed to be extremely self-critical because they couldn't really find anything wrong with it, which means we did our work correctly.
Thank you.
George Gershwin always said that Reiner was the best conductor of his music. And here are Reiner, Gershwin, Deems Taylor, and Robert Russell Bennett at Louisone Stadium in 1931. Gershwin, of course, died in 1937, and his loss was keenly felt in a way that probably hasn't been comparable to an American classical composer since then. We've lost people who we keenly missed in the world of pop and rock. But in any event, Reiner decided to commission Bennett to devise a suite from Porgy and Bess, which had not been an entirely unalloyed success since its premiere. He thought it would be a way to get the music better known. So from that recording, made in 1945, it was part of the same session, we're going to listen to a portion, and again, here is a man who's used to conducting Wagner, Strauss, Mozart, Beethoven. Listen to his complete identification with this music of George Gershwin. ¶¶ The symphonic picture from Porgy and Bess by Robert Russell Bennett may have been Reiner's most important commission. An even more important thing in which he was connected, although he didn't actually commission the work, was Béla Bartók's Concerto for Orchestra. There are the two of them in 1942 at Reiner's Connecticut home. Bartók, of course, dying from leukemia and can't earn any money and is basically close to destitute. So Reiner goes to Kuzovetsky and encourages him to commission from Bartók a major orchestral work that would give him enough money to live on for the remainder of his life. And the result, of course, the Concerto for Orchestra. Reiner made the first recording of the work in Pittsburgh in 1946. And we're going to listen to the Game of Pears from that recording. Again, this is from the master lacquer and bears little resemblance to anything anybody ever heard on LP or 78. Thank you. That was recorded in 1946. Reiner wanted his orchestra to make the first recording, even to the point where he would accept certain weaknesses in the playing that he otherwise would not have, because he felt it so important that the work be heard. That's why that lovely trumpet entrance in the trio did not get axed. Now we're going to listen to what we were almost going to listen to before, but I chalk it up to operator error. Anyway, at the time that the Concerto for Orchestra was premiered, it's hard to remember, but Manuel de Falla was still a living composer, one of the many living composers whose music Reiner programmed. And this is his only shot at El Amor Brujo, and we're only going to hear a little bit of it. This was a recording made with the American contralto Carol Bryce. Actually, I'm not sure if she was a true alto, but anyway, she did Mahler's Lieder einer Fergen. Let's try that again. Lieder eines fahrenden Gesellen and the El Amor Brujo with Reiner. They were released on 10-inch LPs at various times. And Carol Bryce is a voice that is pretty much faded from the scene, but she was prominent in the late 40s. We're just going to hear the fire dance from Falla's El Amor Brujo. Thank you. ritual fire dance from El Amor Brujo by Manuel de Falla, FRITZ REINER and the Pittsburgh Symphony, and you can see Reiner next to Goddard Lieberson and Edward Wallerstein listening to one of Columbia's new LPs, which is the source for the fire dance. It is on a 10-inch LP. Yes, Jim?
Is that picture reverse left right?
Well, that's the way I got it. So if to
look at the phone. Well,
yeah, he's picking up the arm on the wrong side.
Thank you. I can't remember where that came from either. Anyway, that's one of the few things that supposedly one can't do
Photoshop?
No, you can do a lot in Photoshop. You can falsify everything in Photoshop. But anyway, here's a picture of Reiner smiling. Didn't happen very often. And
fired somebody.
he and his wife were on their way to a cruise, which they often did in, I mean, not that kind, but an ocean voyage, where he always went to Europe in the 40s after he could. And that rather boxy sound is, again, brings us back to one of the reasons that hearing these lacquers is so meaningful, as to what was really coming out of Pittsburgh during this period of time. And we're going to finish with another Strauss score. Reiner's biggest problem was that when he got to Chicago, he re-recorded much of this repertoire, and it all sounds better than his Pittsburgh version because he was dealing with a far, far superior orchestra. And we need to just celebrate the intensity that this man could generate and the abject fear that he could inspire in musicians, whatever it took to get them to do what he wanted them to do. That was his idea. And also I wanted to mention the next thing we're going to listen to is the Kitchen Maid's Dance, which concludes the suite from Le Bourgeois Gentilhomme. When Seth and I were experimenting with some of these lacquers, playbacks, I should say, back in 1994 and 95, we made flat transfers of some and then put EQ back in, supposedly in the digital domain. It was an abject failure. And so now we had the flat transfers available to us, but Seth had meanwhile had his archival preamp rebuilt, and we were able to benefit from the far superior sound. That's just an introduction to this delightful conclusion to this survey of Reiner Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra recordings. Thank you very much. Of course, we also have to thank FRITZ REINER and his memory for those wonderful abbreviated performances and portions thereof. Does anyone have any questions? I see a questioner down in front. Sheldon?
What's that 1940 side, I think it was the Rite of the Valkyries?
Yes.
For release?
Well, it suggested it is. I haven't laid my hand on it. It would have been on probably on a 10-inch. I may have one. Things are so disordered where my 78s are now that I couldn't have laying hands on it, but it's suggested in the documents that it was the one item that they could approve from that first session in Carnegie Music Hall.
Dennis?
Yes, John?
I've noticed that on many 78 pressings and also on the sheet that you put up there that they list only one take. What exactly does that mean, since clearly there were multiple takes or you couldn't have been able to choose to edit things together?
Well, you could use the A's and the B's, which is how they slip-cued the sides. So in the cases where Reiner and Roginski were so productive that they had hardly any retakes, you know,
that
I mean...
That seems to be true about almost all Columbia artists.
Yes, because, well, first of all, they were the junior company, and they did... were cheap is what they were, and they wanted to, they didn't want to have to, they liked conductors who could get it down in one take. And it's amazing to look at the sheets for Reiner and Roginski and Ormandy later on and just see the sheer productivity that was accomplished in those sessions, which were held at about 1 year intervals in many cases. Metropolis was less successful in that respect, but
can I clarify that? Because I saw some things on some of the record lab sheets. When they put a take one down, that meant the approved take. It could have been the fifth take.
That was my question.
Yeah. And in fact, an interesting thing was when I did some Arau material, he couldn't approve anything. They had actually take zeros, meaning alternates.
However, one thing they did do was list every cut of every disc was listed on the lab sheets, whether they were approved or not.
Right.
But frankly, the tendency of Columbia artists was to, in most cases, be very efficient in their production. Now, Sheldon, you had another question.
Yeah, what was the Beethoven second taken from?
16-inch lacquers. But that was from, that was an issued Masterworks series.
Masterworks Heritage.
Heritage issue.
That what we heard came from the lacquer?
That is correct.
And what kind of cartridge was used on the lacquer?
Oh, for that one?
For any of them?
Probably.
All of them were the Stanton 500s with different size styli. There were certain ones we did. I think the Gershwin one was done with the V15 Type 5. That I remember we had a problem when we were dubbing it. The end of one of the sides on both lacquers got very noisy. So I went over, I said, all right, guys, hold your nose. And I took some rubber cleaner and just wetted the disc very slightly. And we played back the ends of both of them. I got quiet ends out. The engineer was sitting there. He had a turtleneck sweater on. He went like this with it because it had stunk up the studio. But I got, you know, then threw the towels out that I was working with. So... By the way, the El Amor Brujo was from the LP, and that's why it doesn't sound as good, and even after fixing it, it still has some pitch instability in it.
When they went to dub those lacquers to either matrices, in the case of the pop items, one-sided items, or when they slip-cued to create the longer works, they had a lot of problems with turntables with insufficient speed stability. They worked very hard to get around that. That was one of the things that Howard Scott was vividly remembering was all the trouble with getting turntables that didn't exhibit pitch problems or wow or flutter.
You remember what he said about that? Originally, when they were trying to do the first LPs, they did it with belts and a timer. you know, it's trying to slip cue some of the larger pieces together, and he said it was a disaster. They hired him because he had a degree in music and he was also an engineer, so he used to say you'd have the scoring from him, and then he'd say, okay, guys, 10, 9, 8, and then he said, when I'd snap my fingers, let the other disc go, and then fade down the first one. And he said something also in the interview. They had to get, 100 releases ready, I think, for the announcement in the fall of 48.
Right.
And they get halfway through it, and who was it? Wallerstein came down and said, guys, we cut it with the wrong size stylus.
No, it was Edward Bachman.
And they had to start all over again.
It was June
of 48, but they were starting in late 47. So they had to start the whole thing all over again. He said he brought a couch in to sleep on because they had to get through this backlog. And he told me, he said the only time he could get any sleep was when they were doing the pop items. Because that, you know, he could tell them, you take this, slip cue this together, make a site. And that's when he would take a nap. And then when they had to do the big orchestral things that required the slip cue editing, then he would, supervise it.
Or knowledge of reading a score.
Right.
Yeah. One thing I do want to mention, and I will answer your question right afterwards, is the importance of your contributions to our New York chapter. With your help, we were able to purchase this little amplifier over here, which is going to enable us to improve the playback in this room for future presentations. We haven't put it through its paces because there wasn't time based on our tardy arrival, but your contributions do make a difference, a significant
yes.
one.
Thank you.
Okay, there was another question up there.
The piece that preceded the Shostakovich Six, the little Tchaikovsky.
Oh yes, from the suite number one.
Right, that was not issued, is that right?
That's correct, for want of a coupling, apparently.
Was there a reason, or just there was no place?
For want of a coupling.
For want of a coupling.
Yeah, there were so many orphan odd sides that were recorded over the years. John can attest to that as well. They were supposed to go somewhere, but they forgot about them or changed their minds or something. So anyway, it was just something we found when we went through those lacquers for that session, because there was so much that was worked on for eventual reissue. Yes, Sheldon.
Was Sony the owner of Columbia at the time we were doing this?
Yes. Sony bought CBS in 1990. This work was begun in 1994. And Masterworks Heritage, the first launch was in 1996. The line continued until 1999, when Peter Gelb, of the less the said the better, decided that we were going to pull the plug. So we got 60 releases in that line done before that happened. We had hoped to be able to bring it up to an even 100, since that was the so-called centennial of the Columbia disc record.
Any reason given when he...
Peter? Peter? Reason? Peter?
No.
Hitler, as he was known affably in the... You know, Sony Classical was known as the Reichskanzlerei in 1942 or the Politburo in 1952 during his administration. And so it's no different than what was recently in the New Yorker a few weeks back about his contributions in that respect to the morale at the Metropolitan Opera. Anyway, he's the reason that there weren't any more releases in the series. But his Tender Mercies had pretty much done in Sony Classical as a label anyway by the time he moved on. So it would have happened later if not then. And it was fun to work on. We got some good things out, and it was that in itself is its own reward.
Well, you should thank Dennis, because he was the figurehead for that project.
I don't think you mean figurehead.
No, no, I don't think so. I was the mover and shaker is what I was.
The mover and shaker behind the entire series.
The catalyst.
The catalyst.
That's a better word.
Yes, Richard.
The CD packages of this material and the Chicago Symphony broadcast recordings that are being offered now.
Yeah.
Qualitatively, what do you think of those
Al, have you heard that package? I can't qualify.
I bought the Reiner package because it was on sale. I've not heard it. Allegedly, they used whatever the latest mastering was on each recording, whether it be the best one or not.
Right. So, for example, pardon me, John?
That's the way to do it.
Right. So, in other words, what you just heard of the Bourgeoisie Gentilhomme?
That's not in the Reiner set.
It's not in there?
It's going to be.
No,
it's in the Master Chicago set.
I don't think he includes Pittsburgh,
does it? It's Chicago and the two. FRITZ Symphony's done in New York, and that's the...
Oh, that's it. I thought they included Pittsburgh in there.
I wish they had, but they didn't.
Okay. Well, what would happen is that they would probably pull the tape transfer.
For Pittsburgh, the Strauss set, I believe they included some of the Pittsburgh Strauss recordings.
All right, that's in there then.
And there's also a Masterworks Heritage set,
yeah,
which they put together.
They put all the Masterworks Heritage issues into one.
Okay, but for example, these items that you heard that we never put out...
No.
Will not sound as good as this because they went and pulled LP production master tapes.
Unless you did work for them and turned it into them, you might have used
it. No, it wasn't turned in because it never happened.
No, things would be
they wouldn't know anyway.
Hmm?
If you had, they wouldn't know about it.
Of course not.
I did a transfer of something I got paid of that got lost, the Franck Sonata with Francis Scotti and Kasatsu that sounded fabulous. It took them almost 2 years to record it with all the takes. But that went in, and it never saw the light of day. It's a set of dats that are sitting somewhere in the archives that nobody knows about.
Do you still have it?
Unfortunately, no. I didn't have the brains enough to copy that when it was there. It was a very fast rush job in and out from what they wanted at the time.
What did you end up using? What, the tape they had?
I don't. Did they finally put it out? Did they?
I think they put it out in France.
Possible. Well, then they probably used
that
an LP.
George Kadar using 7.5-inch tape copy.
Oh, please. Those things with dummy stereo and a little echo added to sweeten it up. Well, Dennis, I want to thank you again. This really was a magnificent program.
Thank you very much. Enjoyed doing it.
Yes. We had a lot of fun doing this, and we were sitting there both looking at each other and said, could you imagine if I had the disc now doing it at high res directly in, what these things could sound like? But what absolutely amazed me was how quiet the playbacks we got on these things, that most people would not believe those are off of discs. In fact, I defy anyone to find tapes 10 years later that sound that quiet.
Well,
the background noise without any pre or post echo problems.
The proof of the pudding is in the fact that the system is often louder than the medium.
Yeah. We would drop the needle and you could actually hear them turn the system up.
Which only reinforces my stated opinion that if the industry had stayed with lacquers and let tape go off and do something else, we would have had more recoverable quality material to work with once we had entered the digital domain with the fewer remedial problems. Tape is nothing but one giant remedial problem, whereas lacquers, as we've discovered, if they have survived in good estate, can be made to sound can be made to sound excellent without nearly as much effort.
Okay. Well, just to let you all know.
May. Don't forget May.
Yes, that's what I'm doing. Yes. Okay, our next program is going to be May 21st, which is, what are we at, the 16th? So that's going to be 5 weeks from now. Our guest speaker is going to be Al Schlockmeyer, who will present excerpts from the UN Day concerts and outline the work involved in preserving and digitizing the world body's audio documents. He had presented this at the last ARS conference in truncated form, and we'll be able to give an extended program, which will include longer excerpts and many items that he did not include. These are the recordings that the UN made starting in 1949 on the anniversary of Human Rights Day on December 10th, and then their annual concerts that were always on October 24th. So starting in 1949 to the present, they had recorded every one of these concerts. And it was quite a task to get everything digitized, and it was due to his persistence and help that project went forward. And if you like this program, the one next month is going to be even more interesting. And that will be on the heels of us going out to the National Conference, which will be the week later, the day after Memorial Day. It's when everybody's going to be heading to Pittsburgh. So I want to thank you all for coming tonight and see you in 5 weeks. I think you'll really enjoy that program too. Thank you again.